Thanks for that, Sam. So from a kind of a bit of a history lesson and looking forwards to all these amazing new beers that we're going to be able to taste soon, looking forward to that, that will be good. We're now going to find out just a kind of wider, bigger picture, like look into the future. And so Paul Marrow is going to be telling us about 2020, a new decade.
Good evening. Unfortunately, there's no beer in this talk. There also doesn't seem to be a talk. Oh, yes, here it is. Well, 2020, is it a new decade? Are we there yet? Can I leave now, please? That's what I'm going to talk about. This is 2020. But we need to understand first what a decade is. Well, we can look at an album that was released by Joy Division in 1980, and the song Decades. Do you think this song tells us what a decade is? Well, you can stream this track if you want to, but I recommend buying the album because I've been playing that in the cover. So what is a decade? Think about where we started counting these years. We started counting the year one. Unfortunately, so what was the number of the year at the end? I haven't told you there, but it's here. We're now a long way away from that. So the beginning of a decade has the number one on it now, and the end has 1-0. So something might have happened. It hasn't happened anything. It's in the same number one. So it's 10 years, 10 numbered years. So what does that mean about 2020? So it means that 2020 is not actually the beginning of the decade, and neither was 2000. But it's not a problem, so we can still relax, as suggested by this poster around the beginning of the millennium, and it really doesn't matter. But 2021 will actually be the beginning of a new decade. We don't know exactly what will happen, but I reckon that what you see in that picture will not. Look at the flag right at the end of that collection of flags. That was taken a few years ago. What's happening after 2020? Well, we know we're going to get older. It's a pity, really. This comes from our friends in the US, and if you look at where the curves are, they'll give you the likelihood of how people of different ages will survive in the US. The good thing is, a lot of those curves are quite near one. Another good thing is, survival from your current age is not certain. A lot of people will be near the mean survival, but other people will live longer, and other people will live shorter. This is the so-called normal distribution. And for all those women in the audience, you don't have to be in the Liverpool FC women's team, which is this one, but most women in large populations compared to men will live longer than men, which for me is unfortunate, but I know this to be the case. The other good thing is, we are all different people. We are not the same. And we were definitely not the same when we walked away from the Mersey after the Giants visited, and I took this photo. And so each of us is going to live in a different way. And that's going to continue to be the case after 2020. Now, if you talk to your GP, they may say there have been problems involved in, for instance, drinking from the bar here or smoking, but yeah, I'm sure you can also think of people who may have lived a really long time despite doing that. Your GP or other people may say that you should have a very balanced diet or that you should engage in intensive regular exercise and will live much longer and get good benefits. But once again, that will affect different people differently. And if you have the pleasure of a new arrival in your family, that new arrival will look into the future beyond 2020 in a very different way. As we all here get older, they will also get older, but they will be young adults at the time when we'll get somewhat older. The main common feature is that we have to fit in this vaguely round thing sitting on the slide at the moment. And that's going to be a bit of an issue because there's some other issues associated with it over time. Certain people have tried to predict what our current island will look like in 2100, which is a bit beyond 2020. And unfortunately, Liverpool seems to have disappeared on this map. So this is wild speculation. But sea level rise is a feature. The reason there's a bull on this picture is that, well, bulls are part of rearing cattle for beef and milk, and it's a big feature of farming these days, but it's actually very inefficient. So that may have to change in the future. And here is one of many diagrams of the internet, which has produced many useful things for us, some of which we've already heard today, but it's also produced new sources of crime and warfare, and we can't rule out those in the future, which may be disruptive. Now, I'm sure you may know what this is. This is a coronavirus from the CDC matter, and I was hoping by the time I talked about it, it would have gone away, but it doesn't look like it has yet, but hopefully it won't be as bad as we think. And after talking about some of these things which sound negative, this may actually be better than we think, and that's why there's a smiley in the middle here. Be happy, because being happy is good for you, whatever happens. And just, you know, just be happy, really. And at this point, since a lot of these estimates were based around big numbers, I should stop, because I'm not a number, I'm a person. And this was said in the 1960s, and sometimes this television series comes back, so I'm definitely going to stop now.
Thanks a lot, Paul. Right, so Paul talked about the importance of having fun. And one of the ways you do that is by playing games. But our next speaker is maybe going to tell us about other things you can do when you're playing games. I'm sure we'll find out in a moment. If you welcome to the stage Hua Young, who's going to tell us about Games for Change.
This is not Games for Change that I'm talking about, it's one particular game that might change. Right. This is the game I'm talking about, it's called Probationary, and it's about being on probation. This is not the period before you get a full contract, by the way. So, I was asked to make a game, no, I was asked to make an art piece about what it's like to be on probation. I have no experience of this, so, I went to Google, did an image search. This is how I start off any sort of research. It's not very helpful. So luckily, I had men on probation and their probation officers to help me with this. So this is what I did. The reason I used a game is because I think board games give you a point of view of life. Like this one's called The Mansion of Happiness. This one, How to Get Married, is a board game for children, little girls. So I want to know what men on probation thought their lives are if viewed as a board game. And it was a nice way to discuss how they viewed life. And I like this quote by Gregory Bateson, an anthropologist. Sorry, he did lots of stuff. Anyway, the point about games or playing is you find a safe space to test out real-world issues. And I did this with the men and their probation officers and criminologists. We spent time talking about what's fair, is life fair, it's not fair, why is it not fair, what does winning mean if you're on probation. And it went through a lot of discussions. It was a series of negotiations where I tried to get people to understand that they're in a system and it's a shit system, but that doesn't mean you can't change the system. That's why I have this iced tea quote. We went through making it and then turning it into a prototype with lots of 3D printed stuff, where we talked about what the tokens should be and how the aspects of the gameplay could be turned into a realistic product, which is this. I think it was nice for everyone involved to be a part of this process, because art in prisons usually tend to focus on rehabilitation for the individual and dissidents, whereas this project tried to get a system view of the criminal justice system. And it wasn't about each individual's man's experience of probation. It was more a holistic system-wide view of what it's like to be on probation. And the reason this was quite important was because I wanted to use art to get people engaged in thinking about the overall situation that they're in, rather than turning into something to make you feel like you're just in a bad place, and there's nothing what you need to do is feel better about being in a bad place rather than trying to change the bad place. And that's what I've been doing since I made this game with the men, to take it to people and play it with people, and play it with people who have more power than they do. So I've taken it to, this is a Tate Exchange, criminology conferences, art, design, games, lots of different disciplines for people who are not just in the criminal justice system, so they have more empathy around this, but equally trying to take it to people within the criminal justice system, such as the Prison and Probation Ombudsman, or the Ministry of Justice, Probation Policy Team, so that this sort of shared gameplay and empathy could have some real-world impact into how probation policy is shaped, or the end user journey is considered within this, because really you're discrediting a whole bunch of people within our society if you just write them off in this way. Anyway, if you want to play this, I've booked a table at Sugar and Dice a couple weeks time. I can't promise you it's fun, but you know, not everything has to be fun.
I've played probationary, and it definitely, I definitely was changed. Like, it was, I learned stuff about how shit being on probation is. So it's like, I recommend it. I don't really play board games, but enjoyable is maybe not the right word, but would play again. Right, now our last speaker of the first half is Emma McClure, and she's going to be telling us about fussy eating fables. Welcome to the stage.
So towards the end of last year, a boy went blind from eating chips. This is quite a big story, but if you didn't see it, a young man who was 18 years old had for his whole life eaten basically only chips, and as a result of that, he had gone blind due to nutritional deficiency. And at first blush, that sounds absolutely ridiculous. How could you think that you were ever going to be okay if all you ate was chips? I know it's hard to get children to eat their vegetables, but this is ridiculous. And you think about the parents and you think, how on earth could you let your child just eat chips? Sounds like absolutely stellar parenting. And that was the view that quite a lot of people I saw who were commenting on news stories like this had at the time. And you'll see that in the next slide. And when I saw these news stories, I was a bit annoyed as well. And so I was sufficiently annoyed that I actually complained to the BBC about their reporting. And by complained, I mean I tweeted at them, because that's the modern way to complain. And within an hour of doing that, I was being interviewed on BBC Radio 5 Live by Nihal. Now, you might well wonder why just being annoyed at a news story led me to being interviewed on national radio. And the reason is that I spotted something that was missing from the initial reporting of those stories. And the reason that I noticed something was missing is because the diet that was described the young man had is almost exactly like my diet. That's me from 5 years ago at Ignite. I am in my 30s, and since I was 18 months old, my diet has consisted of six things. Those six things are white bread, chips, chocolate, green apples, smooth strawberry yogurt, Walkers, specifically Walkers, salt, vinegar, crisps, and that's it. And the reason for that is because I and the boy in the news stories suffer from an eating disorder. And that eating disorder is called Avoidant Restrictive Food Intake Disorder, shortened to ARFID. And that was what was missing from the reporting. It didn't mention, at least initially, that he had that condition. Now, to be fair, I didn't know I had this condition until the middle of last year, and it's only been a diagnosable condition for a few more years than that. Before that, I was a fussy eater, I was a freaky eater, and that's how I described myself, because that's how everyone else described me, and the society described me, friends and family described me, medical professionals described me that way, and that's how it was. But it's actually a bit more sort of significant than that. For me, it's different for everyone, but for me, it was an extreme aversion to any taste and textures that weren't on that list, and I couldn't explain to you why things were and weren't on the list. But the best analogy I can come up with is the difference between being asked to eat toast and being asked to eat the toaster. It's that different in my mind. Now, luckily for me, because my diet's slightly wider than that boy in the story, I've not had any physical health issues with it, but it's been quite a significant social disability for me. You don't realise quite how much food is part of life unless it's something that you basically avoid. And before this diagnosis, it really felt like a moral failing to me, like I was some kind of millennial snowflake who just needed to get over myself, and that was the view of quite a lot of people in relation to the story at the end of last year. But when I had the diagnosis, it was quite a revelatory moment for me, because then actually it wasn't that, it was a serious condition and I was able to get help and therapy. And I've actually, just before this talk, been at the Liverpool Eating Disorder Service having a session with them, and because of that I've been able to make massive, massive progress. And the rest of the slides are going to be food that I managed to eat the last year. This is the first remnants of the first main meal I ever ate in a restaurant ever, at the age of 31 last summer. And so I've been able to make a great deal of progress, and I've been able to shift my brain slightly with professional help to think that maybe toasters might be edible. So for the first time in 30 years, I am trying all kinds of new things. I'm using cutlery for the first time, which is hard to learn for the first time if you've never done it before. I'm cooking for the first time. I'm having meals with my partner, something I've never done in 8 years, and that's absolutely fantastic. I'm also learning that this is something that actually affects more people than I thought it did. So if you recognise anything in this talk, please do go and seek professional help from your doctor. They can refer you to people who can help with this. Things that didn't help: being scoffed at, being called a fussy or a freaky or a picky eater, being told if you'd ever really been hungry enough, you'd have eaten. I actually did nearly starve myself to the point of hospitalisation when I was a small child, and that didn't make the toaster any more edible. No one chooses to eat this way, and if I could have fixed it myself, I would have done that in a heartbeat. And if you told me a year ago I would be eating things like that, I would not have believed you. That's a toaster, you can't eat toasters. So I just wanted to highlight that it's actually quite a serious mental health condition. It can have very serious physical implications, as with the young man in the news stories. If not, it can have serious mental or social consequences, as it has done for me. So I hope that you found that interesting, and that you take away from this, if you hear someone so fussy or a picky eater, there might be more to it. And in the meantime, I'm going to catch up on the 30 years of pizza I've missed out on. Thanks for listening.
So, well, you know, lots to kind of to mull over in the interval. Loads of like interesting, clean as ever, loads of interesting and thought-provoking talks. So that's the end of the first half. We're going to have about 20-minute half-hour break. So get yourself a drink, have a chat to somebody you've not met before, or somebody you've met loads of times, and it's all fine. Just be friendly as you all are. If you've got any 1-minute pitches, come and find me in the interval. And if you want to do the Ignite karaoke, similarly, come and find me in the interval. But otherwise, I shall see you in half an hour.